All right. Thank you, Karina and Vishwa. That was great, and that was interesting to learn about Build as well. I'm Steve Kate, and it's terrific to be here with everybody tonight. And thank you for taking the time to be with us. I'm really excited to have this discussion with you all and talk about government and emerging technology. As Karina said, please feel free to put any questions or comments in the chat, and we can address them throughout. This is a topic, government and an emerging tech, that's near and dear to my heart. I'm fairly new to Microsoft. I've been here for about 8 months now, and I'm coming from a career in the government. I had 18 years there, ranging from Air Force active duty to intelligence community, at the National Reconnaissance Office, then up on Capitol Hill on the House Armed Services Committee. And then my last position was in the Pentagon at OSD Space Policy. So I'm excited to be here at Microsoft now alongside an amazing team helping bring the technologies to the government and really advance your mission. So let me hand it over to my friend and colleague, Chirag Parikh, to introduce himself, and then we'll dive into the material.
Yeah, hi. Hey, thanks, Steve, and thanks, everybody, for joining as well. So my name is Chirag Parikh. Been here about a year and a half here at Azure. Been working Azure Space. We publicly announced it late last year, but it's been based upon the hard work of a large team putting together products and services that we'll talk a little about here today. And so for me, similar background to Steve, I've had 22 years in federal service between being an intelligence analyst for the Air Force, then going to the Director of National Intelligence Offices, and then working for 6 years, kind of a counterpart to Steve when he was on the Hill at the White House on the National Security Council staff as the Director of Space Policy. And then finally, before coming here to Azure, I worked at the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency working on GEOINT analysis and collection operations. So pleasure to be here. Looking forward to engaging with folks in the future. And back to you, Steve, to talk begin our conversation about space.
Okay, great. Thanks, Rock. So this is kind of this overall set of briefings is a bit of a just whet your appetite. So if you're interested in learning more, please reach out to us and we're happy to give a more in-depth briefing. So before we talk about what Microsoft is doing in space, we thought that it would be helpful for some people that may not be familiar with what's going on more broadly in the space environment. And it's the bottom line is it is a really exciting time in the space sector, and really, in fact, it's unprecedented in a lot of areas in the change that's happening. And there's lots of ways to kind of measure the metrics, whether it's the investment going into space now, the number of satellites that are being launched, the miniaturization that's happening, the countries that are getting involved, or even certainly from a government perspective, standing up a space force, the new branch of the armed forces, which is certainly a really historic move and really drives focus on this critical domain. Outside of the government, there is tremendous focus happening as well. And in fact, that's some of the most exciting changes that are happening is the commercial sector is realizing how important space is and is really investing in this industry. So whereas the government was really driving a lot of the technology in the past, what's happening now is commercial technology is really driving a lot what that's happening in this domain now. And that opens up new opportunities really for everybody, whether it's the soldier, sailor, airman, marine, guardian, or farmers, or bankers, or everyday people. But there is challenges with everything that is happening in space. There's massive amounts of data. There's new forms of connectivity, but how do you break down the silos and bring the connectivity to really anywhere and connect it to the cloud? And then really moving at speed. And this is where we are trying to help. So if we go to the next slide, So what is Azure Space? This is all about bringing the cloud to the mission needs of the space community. And as Chirag said, we've started it about a year and a half ago and brought it public in this past October, and have been growing our team and products and services. And if you go to the next slide, we have a differentiated approach in how we are doing it. We are really driven by partnerships. This is an essential part of our strategy. We see that there is tremendous innovation that's happening in the space sector, and what we want to do is bring our technology alongside those partners. So as an example, we've partnered with SpaceX. They have over 1,000 satellites in low Earth orbit in their Starlink constellation to provide space-based broadband. That's growing by about 60 satellites every couple of weeks. And what we're doing is bringing the power of their satellites, as well as others, SES and a number of other space companies, and working with our ground infrastructure, our cloud computing, to unlock all sorts of new scenarios. And when we think about who these solutions are for, it's really for the entire cycle of the space ecosystem. So developers, operators, whether NASA, Space Force, commercial companies, and then at the end of the day, users of space systems. So, and this is where, as I'd mentioned earlier, that could be the soldier, sailor, airman, marine, scientist, farmer, or others. So let me hand it over to Chirag now, who's going to talk more about the technologies that we're developing.
Hey, thanks, Steve. So really, when we think about the technology that we're developing, we really think about this into four different sectors here. And to Steve's point before, it's in bringing the innovation across Microsoft, along with the space partnership ecosystem. And really, while we're not launching satellites, we are working with those that do to be able to provide this integrated fabric of space for the end user. And so when you think about that from a global connectivity perspective, what we're trying to do is not say one system, another constellation, another satellite. When you think of the system of systems, you bring those together and you have the opportunity to be able to connect anyone's data from anywhere in the world at the security level that you need in and out of our clouds, our hyperscale clouds, and our edge devices as well. So that's the first element. But having come from the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, data is king, and you have a lot of access to a lot of data, but the real value is when humans and machines turn that data and knowledge into insights. And sometimes that requires developing synthetic training data to develop artificial intelligence models. Sometimes that means just being able to link a lot of different data sets together to be able to provide visualization and understanding of what you're looking at it in the first place. Then you go to a world of digital engineering. And this is really technology that you need to be able to innovate, whether you're developing space systems, operating space systems, or being able to use the data coming from those space systems. So for instance, as the government and commercial space organizations are developing satellite constellations, some of these numbering in the dozens of satellites, some of these numbering in thousands of satellites, for instance, like the Starlink constellation, this is going to require precise and planning and sophisticated AI-driven approaches and protocols to ensure optimal networking, connectivity, and operational coverage on orbit, as well as being able to conduct the analysis on orbit for faster decision-making. A lot of this is going to have to be done through digital engineering worlds, through modeling and simulation, and we can develop that. We are developing that type of ecosystem to be able to enable that. But as I alluded to, it's not just on Earth to do this. We're also looking into space. At what point does a customer need to actually have that AI driven on orbit? At what point do you need to have that form of connectivity from satellite to satellite on orbit? And so as we go from here to the moon and beyond, what do you need to be able to put there? Is it hardware? Is it Microsoft Azure software? We're working with partners to be able to leverage our technology on orbit for capabilities. So if you go to the next slide, I want to go a little bit deeper into particularly the global connectivity story. So at Azure, as we all know, the movement of data around the Earth is critical. It's critical for civil space missions, for national security space missions, as well as for commercial. And this data really can originate anywhere from headquarters to the field, to sensors in all territories, all domains, to include space. So like Steve talked about, the foundation, our foundation is based upon partnerships. And we've leveraged our innovation with these partnerships to enable global connectivity. One of these products is that's in private preview is Azure Orbital. And Azure Orbital, as you'll see, the schematic on the left-hand side is a fully managed cloud-based ground station as a service that lets you communicate with your satellites, uplink and downlink data, process your data in the cloud, and chain your services with existing Azure services that you're already used to. It lets you focus on the mission and product data by offloading the responsibility for deployment and maintenance of the ground station assets. So now what's really interesting about this system is built on top of the global Azure infrastructure of cable, fiber optic cables, undersea cables, and our low latency efforts that we have with through these cables. So while we're building on our ground sites around the world, you can actually see one of the sites there in the middle picture with the radome there. That's one of our sites in Quincy. But while we're building our own ground stations around the world, we're also developing a partner ecosystem to enable customers who are using existing partner ground stations or want to bring in their own ground stations to augment this. We're talking about government and or commercial capabilities. In this case, we partnered with KSAT, Viasat, and USEI so that we can connect Azure to their global distribution of ground sites, who are talking to a multitude of low Earth orbit satellites, as well as get the data back from those sites into Azure, where you can then start using some of those AI services that I talked about earlier. Furthermore, another step that we've taken is to virtualize the RF signal in with partner leaders. So virtualizing their modems, and we've been working with Kratos and Emergent to begin with, to bring their modems into the marketplace. Again, as a customer, you're given these options and types of services that you can virtually deploy at these sites around the world. And then finally, what we're doing, what we believe is a big differentiator, is we're allowing satellite operators to build their ground network on our data center footprint around the world. And we're building data centers all over the world. And that's on top of our global backbone of network operations, which allows for faster time to deployment, which allows for lower latency. In the first case, we partnered with SES to enable their next generation medium Earth orbit mPOWER constellation to augment their network with antenna co-located with Azure data centers. So now you'd be able to transverse data all the way across a private network without ever having to worry about going onto a public network or the public internet. And speaking of SES and SATCOM partners, on the right-hand side is another example of our innovation and partnerships. The trailer size object you see there with the Microsoft logo is called the Azure Modular Data Center, which we unveiled last year. Microsoft designed the MDC to support high intensity secure computing in challenging environments, which you know a lot of our Department of Defense friends and customers work in, and provide organizations with the capability to deploy a complete data center in remote stations. But these data centers may have not be on fiber optic cable. They may be on a cable that might actually malfunction in the middle. So we've partnered with companies like SpaceX, SES, Viasat to provide satellite connectivity as an add-on to these this modular data center. So you have assured communications wherever you want. So it's because of these partnerships that we've announced, other partnerships that we're already working on in the national security community, to be able to provide multi-orbit, low Earth orbit, medium Earth orbit, and geosynchronous orbit, multi-vendor and multi-band connectivity with the power of Azure where and when you need it. So if you move on to the next slide. We'll leave this at the point where if there's any questions, you can go ahead and put this into the chat and we'd be happy to address that. But otherwise, now that we have the satellite connectivity, now we are going into a localized ecosystem. And so now, how do you take that last mile step? And Paul Tillman will talk a little bit about some of the efforts that we're doing with 5G. So over to you, Paul.